My name is Ignacio. As I said, I'm a filmmaker. You see me these days recording everything. But I also run a Facebook page called Spanish Libertarian, and I will try to explain more or less what I've been doing so far, and I hope it's useful for you and the institutions you represent. So here I go. First of all, I would like to make some questions to the audience and questions that maybe we can make ourselves, because it's important to think and to reflect about these issues. And the thing it would be to talk about what if we are being persuasive or we are not being persuasive? What if our communication is not being effective? What if we are not using social media properly? What if we are not creating a libertarian hegemony? And we've been discussing this topic so far, and I think we should work more or at least should work better. And that's why what my talk will be about. I will divide this talk in three main categories. First of all, I would like to talk with you and think openly about the battle of ideas and the market of ideas that we usually hear this, but sometimes we don't think enough what is it really. Then I would like to also to talk and see what can we learn from conservatives, what are they doing so far from these last years. And finally, I will explain you what I've been doing in my channel. So the first category is battle of ideas and market of ideas. I had the honor also of writing an article about this in the website Values for Europe. Since I've been involved in this movement, I've been hearing the battle of ideas, the marketplace of ideas. I started to think like, okay, but what is it really about? Is it a market of ideas? Is it a battle of ideas? And actually, I think we are in both aspects, but we need to think or maybe rethink what it really means. The market of ideas, it would be something like, you can see here, Coca-Cola and Pepsi, they're competing, they're smashing each other, but they want to convince the audience. At the end, will have more income because they will convince more customers, and maybe the other one will go bankrupt, etc. But I think it's more than that what we are discussing these days. I think it's already a battle, because if one wants to regulate the market and we want to deregulate it, I mean, that goes directly against our own interest. And it might sound bad, but we are intellectual enemies between our opponents, and I think we have to start thinking in this mindset. It might sound raw, but at least this is how I see it. So if we think, well, how can we be influential in the market of ideas? I always say the same quote, that I think we should explain capitalism using the same capitalist system, exactly. What is a little bit sad for me is that socialists actually use capitalism better than us in order to spread their message. And we should think and be self-critics with ourselves. If we understand what capitalism is, we should use it in order to promote it. And what this is actually what any entrepreneur is facing. I mean, the free market is based to the law of supply and demand. We need division of labor inside the different projects, specialization of each professionals. We need innovation, we need to give value to the market, we need leadership in different projects, and we have to accept that some projects will fail and some projects will succeed. That's the easy part, so to speak. But I, especially last year, I was very interested of battle strategy and war strategy knowledge, and I think, and it was mind-blowing to me, because as I said, no, you usually hear, yeah, we have to compete or we have to buy the battle of ideas. And I said, okay, I want to learn about what war strategy really is. And I basically followed the lectures of this guy, Robert Greene. He has these three books. Well, he has more books, but these three books about war, power, and seduction are very interesting. And I think it was related with this whole libertarian hegemony movement that we're trying to do. And he's also based, for sure, with Sun Tzu and his Art of War, the most famous war book ever. So I won't enter very deep into this, but I think it's important to at least reflect a little bit. So Sun Tzu was saying that people should not be unfamiliar with the strategy. Those who understand it will survive. Those who don't understand it will perish. And it, again, it might sound hard, but it makes you think like, okay, are we winning this intellectual battle or are we losing it? Are we thinking correctly in terms of a strategy? I have my own opinion, but I would like to hear yours. Also, in the 33 Strategies of War of Robert Greene, he says that the great war strategist mindset, it tends to see the big picture. What the big picture means? It means that if you're thinking in terms of big strategy, you can take the risk of losing some battles, but if you lose that battles, it means that you you want to win the war. I mean, you are willing to accept that. And he also says that only a big strategy can give you big results, meaning that if we have a libertarian opinion on many different topics of the social scene, maybe it's not intelligent from us to fight it all. Maybe we can accept that some battles cannot be won now, but if we achieve some pieces of hegemony, let's say, maybe we will win the final war. It's funny, I usually play this game called Go. I recommend you, it's like the Chinese chess. And in order to win, you can lose some mini battles, but at the end, you win the whole war, and that's the big thing. And I see a correlation. Also, Sun Tzu said, this is his most famous war, every battle is won before it's fought, meaning that everything is mental, and if you are stronger than your opponent, and you are more prepared, and you know his weaknesses, it's preferable, it's more predictable that you are going to win. And again, I think our opponents or enemies, let's say, they are more prepared, they know our weaknesses more, and that's why they win, because before each battle they are prepared. And that leads me to this ultimate goal. Sun Tzu also said in one of his most famous quotes, the true objective of war is peace. And that really made me think, like, if we're trying to achieve a peaceful society with prosperity and free market capitalism, we need to fight the war. And fighting the war, it means like getting your hands dirty and maybe some blood even. I think we have to do it because our opponent is already fighting the war. And if we are not using the same strategy, we will lose and we won't have the peace that at the end, it's our main goal. Okay, I'm digging more in my talk. This part was a little bit philosophical, but I think it's important to think about it. The next category, I will show you what can we learn from other people who are not our enemies at all. These are the conservative, especially in the United States and England. So I heard this phrase from this YouTuber called Paul Joseph Watson. I think he labels himself as a conservatarian, and it's kind of funny. And they were making an interview to him in this program called The Rubin Report, that he's a liberal, by the way, he's not a conservative, but it was very interesting. And they were talking about what criticisms could he do, in this case, to libertarians. And he said, and I also wrote an article for Values for Europe about this, in case you want to see more, my opinion. I think the problem with libertarianism is that they are not on the frontier of political discourse. When you have major issues that appear on the news media, one has to seize upon them and tell your story and influence on the popular narrative. This last phrase, tell your story and influence on the popular narrative, but I think it's super important and we are not doing that at all. They, referring to libertarians, they are not reaching anyone out of their inner circle. So that's how I think libertarianism needs to improve in that way. So I heard this phrase and it hurt a lot, but at the end, I mean, it's true. And if something is true, you just have to accept it. At least that's my opinion. So what are the conservatives doing? They are using YouTube and social media in a good way. They are creating engaging events, and they are using symbology or culture. I will show you that. I love all of them, I have to say. All these characters are using, they have amazing YouTube channels, and they are very influential on the social media scene. Daily Wire with Ben Shapiro, Louder with Crowder, the Canadian, Paul Joseph Watson, the English one, Lauren Southern, recently banned in UK, by the way, Milo Yiannopoulos, Irreverent, the funny Gavin McInnes, Dennis Prager with his Dennis Prager University, PragerU. I'm sure you heard it, recently banned on YouTube. When YouTube bans you, that's a good news, by the way. The Rubin Report, he's not a conservative, he's a liberal, but he makes excellent content and a good content for ideas and debates. Also banned from YouTube. They don't allow him to monetize the video. They are unsubscribing him on purpose. I mean, but that's a good sign that when the mass media or the status quo is pointing against you, it means that you're doing something correct. And also Joe Rogan, which he doesn't have any political bias preferable, but he's making interviews to a lot of conservatives and et cetera. And millions of views. I mean, I'm not kidding. It's literally like this. They're also creating engaging events like the Dangerous Faggot Tour of Milo Yiannopoulos. You can see him, that he entered like an hero at the room. Also Ben Shapiro, he made a lot of events in universities, and the social justice warriors try to censor him, and that makes that the news media come to the place, and that gives you even more publicity. Stephen Crowder has created this idea, just going to the street and saying something like male privilege is a myth, changed my mind, or talking about gun ownership and something like that. And it's cool because you're telling your opponents, okay, let's discuss. I am here. If you don't come, that's your fault. And they usually fail of most of the arguments, or not failing, but at least the scene of the discussion, it's open. Also, Turning Point USA, they are creating events, and sometimes they invite socialists, and then there's lots of viral videos, and that creates a lot of intellectual movement and opinion. I think they're using also symbology of culture in a good way with a Pepe the Frog, a lot of memes on the internet when the trying to debunk, let's say, the leftist movement, a lot of Thug Lives video of Ben Shapiro with this rap music and this gangster style. But I mean, this is what it works. I'm not saying I like it or not. I mean, I enjoy it, but that's not the thing I do. But this works, and this engages people. Also, mocking a lot of social justice warriors and radical leftist activists. I mean, it's quite easy thing to do. There was this Facebook page, I think, God Emperor Trump. I'm not especially pro-Trump, but he's not a lefty. We can say or obedience that. And also, I don't know, using figures like George Washington, etc. The good thing about symbology and cultures is that we already know the figures, and there's a lot of concepts attached on this, so it makes communication easy and more effective. And I think they realize that, and they're being clever on their moves. And yeah, more examples. For example, as I said, Charlie Kirk of Turning Point USA here on the center, and wonderful figures such as Jordan Peterson, who apparently he's not fighting any political battle, but he's a psychologist, but he has been fighting against this radical leftist, and I mean, we can see the results, a lot of viral videos and political discussions, and that puts you on the scene. And that comes back to the previous slide where I said you have to say your opinion about what is going on the social scene. And finally, I will try to explain you my project, but I think it was important to show you some perspective of what I've been learning, of what I've been influenced by, and also this idea of being strategic when you are in the social media scene. So in my project Spanish Libertarian, I can proudly say that during this last year, 2017, I increased per 10 the number of followers, and I created new content, I created a new approach, new style, meaning style of the communication that I use, and also the design. And I've been focusing on Facebook. Maybe I will come back on YouTube, but at least that's what has worked for me. Here you can see some data. I mean, at the beginning of 2017, I had like 10,000 followers, and now 2 weeks ago it was like 105,000 followers. I think these are decent numbers. Likes, 9,000, and then 78,000 likes. And more or less, I will try to explain you what I've done in order to achieve these numbers. So the tips for success, I could say, are relatively simple. I've used videos with top and down black bars. I'll show you what it is. I've been using deliberately simple and direct titles in order to deliver my message. I've been using some cultural references too, questions to the audience, and it all ends up to this idea, creating the tribe, creating the community, and I think it worked, at least for me. So top and down bar videos, for example, these are one of the most successful for me. We can see the first one. It's called Individual Responsibility in 3 Minutes, 6 million views. Argentina, Productives versus Parasites, 2 million views. Or How to Talk to a Socialist, 500,000 views. But this video, I think, a think tank from Brazil, I don't remember, they translated and it went viral with 1 or 2 million views. And as my channel is basically on videos, I will show you a 1 minute video. I think it makes sense. So here it goes. So as you can see, I've been trying to use some reference to the culture, using even an irreverent kind of a style, using humor, using direct message, something that makes you feel positive and I don't know, changes the mood for the audience. And okay, I come back to the these tips for success. So first of all, it's top and down bar videos, as you see here, these black bars, and also it's square. It's for the mobile device, because I think people consume more information in the mobile rather than the computer. And again, also super important, simple and direct titles. First video, it says, what do politicians prefer? Keynes versus Hayek. Who pays the public debt? You. Should you be earning more for your job? The fourth video says, this is why socialism won't ever work. Explain in less than 5 minutes. Basic income, that's not working. And this is the raw reality of Cuba. So as you can see, I'm using sound bites. I'm using questions to the audience. Should you be earning more for your job? Who pays the public debt? I also appeal to you. Like you, my audience. I mean, I'm literally talking to you. Who pays the public debt? You, you know? And also, I mean, these big fact claims, I think it works, and I think it creates the incentive for the viewer, the audience, to actually click, to be a little bit aggressive or simplistic, let's say. But at least for me in my experience, and I want to share it with you, has been working. What I've been using is this quote that I always say, that what is difficult is to make it easy. I mean, it might sound counterintuitive, but in what is really difficult is to literally simplify what is already difficult itself. And this is what I've been trying so far. Also, I've been using cultural references, The Simpsons, Public Choice Theory Explained, If It Moves, Tax It, What Is Bureaucracy, Thanks to Asterix and Obelix, Why Is Clint Eastwood Libertarian. Here I had a video of the president of Denmark debunking that the myth that northern European countries are socialist, Antonio Banderas talking about the cultural differences between Americans and Latinos, and also this a guy is a famous journalist who had the bad idea of interviewing a capitalist, and he gets owned. More or less, I mean, you can see the numbers. They are pretty decent. I mean, 800,000 views, more than 500,000 views. Some videos have been surprisingly worked. I'm the first to be surprised, to be honest. Okay, as I told you, I've been focusing also on Facebook, and that allows me to continue in this idea to create the tribe rather than just throwing videos and that's it. And what has been working for me is also to make questions to the audience. For example, in this first publication, I said, how do we libertarians communicate? And how can we convince more people? In this, I would say, let's be friends. Write where are you from, press like to the people near your country, and then send him a message. And this was surprisingly successful. So I think some people want to have online presence, but also being a link between online presence and real offline presence and community, it's super important, and I want to be part of this and with using my platform. And also I made just some questions to the audience. Open borders, yes, no. Freedom of drugs, everything, no one, some of them. Death penalty, against, pro. And also the Fridays, I was doing a 30 seconds video, the Fridays debate, talking about different topics that we, maybe the libertarians don't usually talk. We just usually talk about economy and political discussion, such as, I don't know, are you religious? Do you have an investment on blockchain or cryptocurrencies? Who is your favorite liberal author? What do you think about feminism, etc.? That gives a feeling to the people like, hey, I mean, this is interesting. I want to read some other people's comments about some different topics, and it has been working so far. This last part, as I said, this is my mantra. Creating the tribe. I've been doing this, making some different products. I will show you a video called Yo Defiendo la Libertad, I Stand for Liberty. I've been doing some personalized interviews. I've been using some neuromarketing tips that a collaborator told me. I've been publishing some content related with personal growth that I think it works pretty well, and it's a good idea and a good link in order to defend liberty. And I will show you more or less the 2018 projects that I'm doing. So this is one video that it went quite viral. It's called I Stand for Liberty. And what I did is that I sent emails and messages to many libertarian celebrities of Spain and all Latin America. And they had to send me like 15 seconds video, starting with Yo defiendo la libertad porque. I stand for liberty because, and they just have to finish that phrase. Again, simple message, uncentralized. I mean, I'm appealing to each different countries, Spain, Argentina, Venezuela, Colombia, America, for instance. And also what I did that is, in the same video, I used some celebrities, but I also used some anonymous people, celebrities like Enrique, who is here, by the way. And it worked pretty well because I think some of the people were proud, like, wow, I'm appearing on this channel. I'm appearing close to this professor and some activists. Let's say that they usually publish the content of some professor or some activist that represent him. Now they can say like, hey, I'm part of this. It keeps this this idea of creating the tribe, and also the community creates the content for me, which is a good idea and very efficient and It creates this idea that I'm part of your project. I'm trying to break the barrier. I don't know if you get me. I've been doing also interviews, which is fun and super easy to do. And I do interviews to YouTubers. I do interviews to interesting people that I know, my friends, and the thing is to make this thing bigger. And also there's a lot of benefits. I mean, it's easy to do. The cost is literally zero. It increases my traffic because if the person is famous, for example, like this guy who is a successful YouTuber, he published it on his wall, and now some of that people will come to my channel. And also I think now it's a momentum a little bit of doing other kind of debates, because I think most of the people are tired of the debates on TV where no one can make a real argument, and I want to give another other kind of content to my audience. Also, these tips of neuromarketing that I'm trying to apply. For example, the first comment I put on every post is like, "Hey, and what do you think?" And that creates the incentive of, "Okay, I will say my opinion. I will recommend my friends." Blah blah blah. The community also must feel that you're committed with them doing some products, as I've showed you so far. And also I try to provide useful content such as tips, arguments, motivational content, rather than just data, charts, or I don't know, some just based on economic efficiency, which is very important, and I love this, but I think this doesn't allow to go out of your own tribe or your own bubble. And as I mentioned, some of the followers can create content for the channel, so I'm talking to you, and you are part of this we. I think you understand my point. Also, I've been creating some personal growth content. I don't know if you can see here the numbers, but for example, this video, how can you be proud of yourself? 2 million views, individual responsibility in 3 minutes, 6 million views. Should you be earning more from your job? 1 million view. And then I've got other videos like how to talk to a socialist, is libertarianism, does libertarianism only benefit the rich? This, for example, the advice for young people that no one wants to hear, for 400,000 views. Divide Argentina in two, productives versus parasites, 2 million views. And I can see this kind of content works, and also think that people are willing to understand this. If we talk about freedom, referring to something out of you, like in the government, taxes, regulation, etc., it's fine, it works, but talking about how can you be free yourself and your mind and the way you behave and not complaining and being responsible, surprisingly, people are more interested if we talk about this, because they said, hey, that is useful for me. That literally makes me better. That makes me more aware. And I definitely try to continue. I will try to continue creating content like this, because you can see the numbers. It worked pretty well. Part of the projects that I'm doing, I create a Patreon account if the members want to support me, and maybe creating some premium content for them. I've been doing, I'll do it more, promote entrepreneurs and coaches, and maybe sell their online courses for them, so they can have the incentive of joining my platform, because they can earn some money, and also the community can have the feeling that they have a good quality content. And again, I want to provide entertainment, knowledge, academical knowledge, if for instance, but also if it's a platform for networking for people, that's even better. And that's what I've been doing so far. So coming back, we have to think what the market of ideas is. We have to think also in a battle mindset strategy. I think we can learn from what the conservatives are doing, and you can see what I've doing so far. So here comes my trick, or my call to action. A friend of mine called Luca gave me this rule, and I think it's a clever idea, and I said, okay, I will keep it for myself. And I called it the 3I rule: imitate, improvise, innovate. And I also, I'm recently more or less an entrepreneur, and I try to use it, and I think it works. Imitate. Okay, I like this content. I usually check it. They do this online university. They do this podcasting. Okay, I will imitate. I will try to make it by myself. Then you improvise, as I did myself. I used this creepy logo, and I made this design by myself, and I'll take a look at it now, and I don't like it at all. This economist came to my city. Okay, I recorded. This guy appeared on the YouTube. Okay, I download the link, and I will put an extract. I mean, the numbers weren't that good, but I started. I improvised with what I had. And then I've been trying to innovate. I gave this talk about, again, war strategy and battle of ideas. I've also interviewed a philosopher in English, so I'm trying to approach a new market. I've been trying to create viral videos made by the community for the community, some also viral videos with other content related with personal growth that we libertarians, we don't talk about this usually. I've changed the design of the image. I've been also uploading the content in audio in case someone wants to hear it when they are in the car, etc. And that would be the big thing. I mean, it might sound naive, give love to the community, okay? But give love or give value, give content, make them feel that they are part of something, and that equals more community and more impact. This is what has been working for me, and I'm not saying that I'm right, but at least this is my experience, and I hope it can be useful for you, and happy to take questions. Thank you.